Yep.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to this week 5 of Global Pediatric Lecture Series. We are very happy the way these lectures are going, and thanks for joining and supporting us, actually. We thank all our speakers who are contributing to this session. So as we said before, the sessions are every week, Wednesdays, 4 o'clock, free for anyone to join from anywhere in the world. And there's no registration required. People can just come to the Aldergay Academy webpage and click the link to join. So today we are looking forward for an exciting session by one of our nephrology colleagues who's going to talk to on HSP, IgA vasculitis. Dr. Lewis Oni is a senior lecturer in pediatric nephrology and consultant pediatric nephrologist at Aldergay Children's Hospital. Dr. Oni has got a lot of research interest and leading exciting projects in the University of Liverpool, and got a special research interest in the renal inflammatory diseases. I'm going to hand over to Dr. Lewis Oni to talk on IgA vasculitis today. Thank you.
Okay, so thank you for the kind introduction. I'm Dr. Louise Oni, a nephrologist at Aldergay, and I'm going to be talking over the next kind of 30 to 40 minutes about Henoch-Schönlein purpura as part of the Aldergay Global Pediatric Lecture Series. So just as an outline for the talk, I'm going to talk a little bit about what is HSP and how common is it, give just two case examples which contrast each other, and then talk a little bit about what might cause it through the etiology and the pathophysiology, and then touch a little bit on the renal, the clinical symptoms and the renal manifestations, and then briefly some of the research updates that might be coming your way in the future. So just as a start, in case anybody noticed the two names that were being used, Henoch-Schönlein purpura was actually recommended to be changed to IgA vasculitis a number of years ago now, when the classification and names of vasculitis were actually revised. And this was consistent with a number of the other types of vasculitis, but Henoch-Schönlein purpura was actually officially thought to be better named as IgA vasculitis because it better represents the biology. But actually, in clinical practice, the two names are used interchangeably. And throughout this talk, I'll be talking about Henoch-Schönlein purpura, or HSP, or also IgA vasculitis, and the names are used interchangeably. So when was it first described? It was actually first described back in the 1800s when a doctor described a 5-year-old boy who, as you can see here, was seized with pains and swellings in various parts of his body, and sometimes had pains in his belly with vomiting, and his urine was tinged with blood, and his skin, the skin of his leg was full of bloody points. And actually that quite nicely describes what we see in childhood HSP. But it was his colleagues a number of decades later, Schönlein and Henoch, who actually went on to recognise that this disorder was often after an upper respiratory tract infection, and that actually they recognised it wasn't always self-limited, and some people had serious kidney involvement as a consequence of this condition. So they got the name and they got the title as Henoch-Schönlein purpura, even though it was described some time before that. So what exactly is IgA vasculitis, or HSP? Well, what we classically know is that it typically presents with this rash, and it's a non-blanching, palpable purpuric rash, which is usually on the lower limbs. And as most parents will know, it doesn't blanch away with a glass test. And this often means that people will present to emergency physicians or A&E departments so that they can get their child reviewed, because sometimes it can have the appearance of the meningococcal type rash because they're educated about that rash. But we usually see that it also has a number of other symptoms, and it can involve the gut, it can involve the joints, and typically the ankles or the joints on the lower limbs, and it can also include the kidneys. And it's the most common type of vasculitis in children, and it's actually fairly common for a pediatrician to see a child with HSP. So there are formal classification criteria that assist with the diagnosis, and these have been shown to produce very good sensitivity and specificity in distinguishing HSP from other types of vasculitis. And what they include is mandatory criteria of having the palpable purpuric rash, but also any one of the following: so abdominal pain or involvement, histopathology that's consistent with IgA deposition or a small vessel vasculitis, arthritis or arthralgia, and renal involvement. So when we look at the different types of vasculitis, you can see on this graph here that in children, by far, it is the most common type of vasculitis that we see. And actually, other types of vasculitis are much more rare in children. And this is in stark contrast to adult vasculitis, where you can see that these are the other types of vasculitis. And actually, the blue triangle here, which is adult HSP, is relatively small. And so the majority of cases of IgA vasculitis present in children, so that about 70% of all cases present in childhood, and only about 20 or 30% will present in adults. So you can see here the typical age at presentation, and I'm sure this will be familiar with many people in our audience, if you look at the graph here, which looked again at a number of different inflammatory diseases, and this tall spike here is HSP, and you can see that the peak age of onset is around about kind of primary age school, primary school age children, so 6 to 8 years old. But actually there's a range right from infants to the teenagers. So it can occur in any age, but it's much more common in the kind of 5, 6, 7, 8 year old children. And that will probably feel quite familiar with people when they see children around that age presenting in their departments. And there's a slight tendency to be more prevalent in the males compared to females. So an average children's hospital will see about 20 to 30 cases of HSP per year, and a district general hospital, which we would call in the UK, or a local hospital, will see about 6 to 12 cases of HSP depending on their catchment population. But it's actually rare for a general practitioner, so in primary care, to see a case of HSP, because they see lots and lots of other people presenting with other diseases, and it's a condition that is rarely presenting to primary care. So it's usually a condition that presents to paediatrician in secondary care and sometimes needs tertiary input. So I'm just going to talk through two cases that kind of illustrate the differences in the presentation that we can see in this disease, although they usually typically have that characteristic rash. And case one is a 7-year-old boy who had one episode of macroscopic hematuria, and he presented to his local hospital. And his local hospital found that his urine had lots of red cells in it, a few white cells, but nothing significant, and they didn't grow any organisms, so they ruled out a urine infection. The child had a normal renal ultrasound scan with two normal appearing kidneys, but he did have abnormal blood tests. He had normal platelets and clotting. So you can see on his first presentation here, when he had one episode of macroscopic hematuria, that he already had an elevated creatinine for a 7-year-old boy, and he had a low serum albumin. He also had a high IgA level in his blood tests, and the rest of his immunology was all normal. And sometimes we do see high IgA levels in IgA vasculitis, but not always. He also had quite heavy proteinuria, and this is nephrotic range proteinuria, which was probably causing the low albumin in his bloods. So further history from his parents was actually that he'd had a mild rash a few months before in the September time, when he'd been very well. He'd had a little bit of abdominal pain, some mild joint pains, and he'd been seen in his local walk-in centre by a professional who thought it was a non-specific rash at the time. And actually the family recalled that it resolved a week or so later, and he didn't have any renal follow-up after that time. And they showed us pictures of this rash, and the rash actually did look consistent with HSP, but hadn't been recognised at the time. And so he went on to have a renal biopsy because he had some renal impairment and heavy proteinuria. And his kidneys showed typical findings that we see with IgA vasculitis nephritis, with expansion of the mesangial cells in the glomerulus, and also staining for IgA positivity. And so he was classified with what we would say is histological classification of 3B changes, and he required treatment. So he went on to have prednisolone treatment and immunosuppression with azathioprine, and just some gastric protection with omeprazole. And over time, his urine protein levels improved. And you can see that this orange line is his blood albumin level, and that normalized after a couple of months treatment, and his creatinine, which had peaked in the kind of 80s, actually began to get nearer to the normal value for his age, which was 60. And so you can see that he had a presentation with a very mild rash, very mild and manageable abdominal pain that didn't require any hospital admission, but yet he had quite significant renal involvement that went on to need tertiary care and immunosuppression. And this is in contrast to a 7-year-old girl who presented, and she had a very, very extensive purpuric rash to her ankles, knees, hips, actually extended to her face, her forehead, her arms and her trunk, very severe joint swelling and pain and severe intermittent abdominal pain. And she presented to a local hospital 8 times with abdominal pain, and as usual was told that this is a self-limiting condition, which it is in the majority, that there wasn't any treatment to be used in the acute phase, and that actually her kidney tests were all okay. She eventually got a referral because of the persisting nature, and we reviewed her 3 months after the diagnosis when we could see that she had a very, very severe and extensive rash. And you can see here that this was characterized by areas of petechiae, purpura, but also very deep bruising type rashes. And she was covered all over her body with some areas of subcutaneous edema. And you can see here that the inner aspects of some of her leg actually has some necrotic areas on the skin. And here a bit closer. So she had joint swelling and pain, but actually that was improving slowly with time. Her abdominal pain had been her main problem during the acute period, which had been very severe and it had been colicky in nature. She'd been admitted to hospital on numerous occasions, unable to tolerate her diet, and had been treated with some fluids. So she was treated with a course of oral prednisolone, which was then weaned over 4 weeks, and that showed a dramatic improvement in her abdominal symptoms. Her urine, her blood pressure and her renal function always remain normal. And interestingly, she did have a significant past history with recurrent tonsillitis and very large tonsils causing some sleep apnea type symptoms for which she was awaiting surgical removal. So she had a skin biopsy due to the severity of her skin manifestations and this longer course than normal. And this confirmed the diagnosis with IgA deposition and a very typical small vessel vasculitis with white cells packed in the small vessels. Her abdominal pain and also her necrotic areas of skin, it completely improved with steroids. And she went on to have a tonsillectomy and adenoidectomy performed at our hospital, during which she actually had a very severe flare of her skin manifestations in the post-op period. 2 years later, she's continued to have a very tricky course with flares and relapses, but these have been relatively mild compared to her initial presentation, and she's been treated with a course of hydroxychloroquine for several months. But what's interesting about this young lady is that she's never had any renal involvement at all. So her urine has completely remained normal. Her renal functions completely remain normal, despite having very, very severe skin and joint and gut manifestations of the condition. So what causes IgA vasculitis? Well, it's an autoimmune condition. We see genetic susceptibility, environmental triggers, and also a susceptible host. And so like many autoimmune diseases, there isn't one defining cause that can trigger IgA vasculitis. And if we look at environmental triggers, this was a very large study performed in Japan with over 16,000 cases of IgA. And what they did is they correlated the incidence of IgA with the prevalence of specific respiratory and also gut viruses. And they looked at these trends over a period of time. And what they saw is that you do see seasonal variation in the presentation of IgA vasculitis. But when they looked more closely with this large number of patients, you could see that actually there were trends in which viruses might be triggering the condition in certain age groups. And these were fairly typical viruses that we would see within different age groups, just in general care, but these seem to be triggering HSP in this cohort. So just to go back over that, you can see that in the younger children, the onset of IgA vasculitis was significantly related to RSV and flu, which spanned actually to middle child age as well. And then the older children were more unusual viruses such as Boca virus and then some norovirus in the middle age group too. So you could see that there were changes in the types of virus that children are susceptible to and their links to the onset of IgA vasculitis, but it does have seasonal variation. So what other triggers might we see? We see ENT infections. As I mentioned, the young girl in my case had tonsillitis, and we do see frequently recurrent tonsillitis or problems with otitis media or rhinosinusitis. a similar condition called IgA nephropathy, where you don't get the vasculitis and you don't get the rash and the gut and the joint manifestations, but within the kidney it looks identical, has shown that there may be some benefit for performing tonsillectomy for difficult cases of IgA nephropathy. And so there may be benefit for a specific group of patients to have tonsillectomy if they had very difficult IgA vasculitis, but trying to pin apart which exact cohort that is very difficult, because there are lots of triggers that could be causing this disease, and it may not just be the tonsils. And so usually if somebody's having difficult and recurrent tonsillitis, then we may consider a tonsillectomy as you would do normally. Poor dental hygiene can also be a trigger, because the IgA is produced within the oral cavity. And a study has shown that dental caries can be seen in up to 70% of patients, and also inflammation, so periodontitis, is seen in over 50%. And in perhaps more commonly in adults, drugs and vaccines and certain antibiotics can trigger the onset of IgA vasculitis. And it's very useful to just double check that there haven't been any recent courses of antibiotics or any illicit drugs or anything in your patient when they're presenting. So what's happening? What we see is that IgA is present in the mucosal secretions and it acts as your first line of defense against pathogens. So it's present in the oral cavity, but it's also present in the lining and throughout the gut. And that's why we probably see a lot of the manifestations arising after an upper respiratory tract infection or even a GI infection. And what's thought to happen in a susceptible individual is that they produce an abnormal version of the IgA, and this triggers the autoimmune response that we see. So they get antibodies against this abnormal IgA and they develop IgA immune complexes, and the immune complexes and the abnormal IgA both are in the circulation at the same time. And what these cause are downstream effects, because they're not able to be cleared away by normal means. So this abnormal IgA is actually produced in a way that means the immune system is unable to clear it away, and it will therefore go on and deposit within the small blood vessels. And what we see is IgA depositing, but along with IgA we often see lots of inflammatory cells, and we usually see complement C3 linked to it too. And all in all, this causes the vasodilatation, and that causes the characteristic rash, and the appearances of the rash are very similar within the gut if you were to look on endoscopy. And we see this leukocytoclastic vasculitis, so lots of inflammatory cells within the blood vessel wall. So the actual IgA molecule itself is believed to be abnormal, and it may be that they have a genetic reason to be producing abnormal IgA, or it could be a temporary phenomenon. And the abnormal area is believed to be this hinge region on the IgA molecule. And what happens is during glycosylation, it's believed to be abnormal in this area, and a substance called GalNAc is exposed, and that's the area that constitutes an antigen and provokes the autoimmune response. And what we know from the literature, and some of this is extrapolated from IgA nephropathy, is that there is binding through this GalNAc into the mesangial region in the kidney, and this could be causing the downstream renal effects that we see within the kidney. So there are a number of genetic risk factors that have been identified, and many of these are commonly identified with other autoimmune conditions such as the HLA gene, and some of them have been identified to actually be protective, so it may be that some of them are more protective and not seen as much in individuals with IgA vasculitis. But again, it doesn't seem to be one genetic susceptibility factor that's causing this disease, and there are a number of different hits that probably are needed before an individual presents with the condition. So I mentioned before that characteristically all patients have skin involvement, and 95% will present with the rash first, and that other 5% usually present with abdominal pain, and then the rash comes on second. And the rash very typically has a symmetrical distribution, and it's usually a distribution which it starts on the ankles and the feet and goes up the legs, and sometimes extends to the arms, and very rarely presents on the trunk or the face. And you can see here in this diagram that it's typically the arms and legs, and you can often see a very spare trunk. You can see a combination of palpable purpura, petechiae, or bruising like the photos I've shown you, And also around the rash, we often see localized skin edema, which can be difficult to distinguish from actually having a joint inflammation. Very rarely, you can get necrotic or bullae in the skin, and this can be quite serious. And if the skin integrity is at risk, it might be an indication for treatment, perhaps with a course of steroids. But this is something that needs to be taken seriously, because if the skin breaks down, then it may be that the patient is at risk of infection. So then we also see the gut, the joint and the kidneys being involved. And I mentioned that if you look in endoscopy, then you can see that inside the gut, it looks very similar to the skin with this visible capillaries. And in the boys, you can also see inflammation in the testes. So we see non-erosive arthritis, GI involvement can extend from being very mild abdominal pain right through to life-threatening hemorrhage and intussusception, which can be an emergency. And as I mentioned, the boys can get inflamed testes. But my interest is in the kidneys, and around 40 to 50% will have some renal involvement. Very rarely patients will present with neurological or lung involvement, and sometimes this might need critical care. And some of these rare complications are actually more common in the adult population, and they may see a more severe manifestation of HSP than what we typically see within pediatrics. So what's the clinical course of this disease? Well, it's good. It's good news. The majority of children get better. They make a complete and they make a full recovery. It usually lasts on average a month. Sometimes takes a few months for them to completely recover, but 70% will make a complete recovery after that first presentation. But there are a few who will go on to have kidney problems, and 4 in 10 will have some degree of kidney inflammation. But if they have severe inflammation leading them to be in a nephrotic state, or they have a nephritic state, so they have a high creatinine, then of that population, 1 in 5 will go on to get irreversible chronic kidney disease, stage 5, needing dialysis or a transplant in the future. So there are a small proportion that will go on to get serious renal consequences from this disease. And in fact, the renal consequences are probably the only long-term serious side effect from IgA vasculitis. And then there will be some people who have relapses or who have a persisting disease where it doesn't settle and it doesn't go away. We see relapses most commonly in the first couple of months, and about 1 in 4 will have a relapse within the first 9 months. And usually if it's within the first year, we'll say that they might have a relapse and then it may settle down. Some people, though, will go on to have several years with multiple relapses, and that might be an indication for specialist input. And likewise, if they have persisting disease beyond this few months where you would expect them to be recovering, then again, they may need specialist input, because it might be that immunosuppression or something will help reverse the disease process. And we typically in pediatrics see that this more unusual cohort are in the older children. So the teenagers are often more at risk of having kidney problems or having a relapsing or persisting course that might require further specialist input. And this is more typical of what they will see in the adult population as well. So how do we treat IgA vasculitis? Well, as I mentioned, by far, it is a self-resolving, self-limiting condition in the majority. If we have severe skin manifestations where you think the skin integrity might be at risk, then that is an indication to consider steroids and to discuss with skin specialists. If you had severe abdominal involvement, such as GI bleeding, severe abdominal pain, needing hospitalization or needing intravenous fluids, then again, there is a soft evidence to support the use of corticosteroids. And usually we would use a kind of a 2-week course of steroids, and then sometimes wean them over the following 2 weeks. And although the evidence supporting this is fairly weak, in clinical practice that often does help improve their abdominal symptoms and usually does allow them to manage their condition at home. So if a patient is needing hospitalization due to their abdominal involvement, then we would consider a course of steroids. With regards to the kidneys, because this is the only serious long-lasting consequence of IgA vasculitis, all children presenting with HSP should have 6 months renal monitoring. And if there is significant renal involvement, which I'll go on to talk about in a bit more detail, then they should be referred to a nephrologist and considered for a renal biopsy to be able to visualize the histology and classify the histology to then just consider whether they would need any immunosuppressive treatment. Lots of patients will have renal monitoring, may have renal involvement, and they'll get better. And during that course, they'll get better. And if their urine and blood pressure is completely normal and their rash is resolved, they don't need any further renal follow-up. So just to summarize, the kidney management in everyone, every patient presenting with IgA vasculitis should have their urine screened for 6 months after diagnosis. There'll be a few who go on to need specialist care and need a kidney biopsy, and then even less who go on who need treatment under a nephrologist. So screening varies. It varies nationally, it varies locally, and it varies internationally. A number of years ago now, we presented what we do at Alder Hey, and we have a nurse-led screening pathway, and we reviewed that pathway and published our pathway to just give some indication and a bit of guidance to what people might be able to use as a template for their own centres. And the general evidence supports this 6 months is long enough to be able to detect. And actually, most patients will present within the first 6 weeks if they're going to have significant renal inflammation. But 6 months allows you to make sure there isn't anybody who presents late. And so what we do at our Alder Hey pathway, which is available in this publication, is we will see patients after a week after their initial presentation, when they've had a urine tested at their initial presentation. We will review them and check their urine then. And if they don't have any protein in their urine at the day 7 review, they will be seen less frequently on what we call a standard pathway, where they'll be seen at 1 month after diagnosis, 3 months after diagnosis, and 6 months after diagnosis. If they have proteinuria, we will see them more frequently because these are the patients who are more at risk of getting renal inflammation. And so we'll see them a week later on day 14, and then 1 month, 2 months, 3 months, 4 months, and then 6 months. And we have strict criteria for when to do further investigations and when to consider a medical review, because they may be patients who need a kidney biopsy or need further intervention. And if a patient who was on the standard pathway developed proteinuria at any point, then we would convert them across to this proteinuria pathway, where we would see them more intensively. So this is trying to filter out those children who are never going to have kidney problems, who are going to be absolutely fine. And we're trying to balance the screening about how frequently they are seen or have a clinical encounter compared to those who are much more at risk of severe kidney problems. And what we found was that this day 7 urine was actually a very good discriminator for a good outcome. And if you had a normal urine at day 7, there was a negative predictive ratio of 97% that you're very likely to have a completely normal course and be discharged from follow-up. And actually, very reassuringly, this was replicated by a group in Japan, where they also found that this day 7 urine, if it was normal, was very reassuring. And they did this in a large cohort too. So actually, we aren't at the stage where we feel confident enough to be able to discharge people, but it does mean that we can see this group less frequently than we would see those who have protein in their urine. And we also confirmed in our cohort that the older children seem to be more at risk of nephritis than the younger children. And so generally the children over about 10, we would consider to be slightly higher risk, but that doesn't change how we screen them at the moment. It may just change how we educate patients that if we saw a patient on day 7 who had proteinuria in their urine and they might be, say, 13, then they might be somebody that we would say you could be at higher risk of kidney involvement, and it's really important we continue the checks to look for that. So there has been a lot of international work more recently, because there has been a recognition that there's a significant lack of research into this condition. And the SHARE initiative was the first international consensus initiative, which looked at recommendations for IgA vasculitis. And they essentially had an expert panel and they used consensus-based process together with the latest literature to design some recommendations for how to manage childhood IgA vasculitis. And further details are here on the paper for you to look up. But essentially, some of the key findings are that they classified the disease, the renal disease, into mild, moderate and severe according to their renal biopsy. And they also did some indications for when to do a renal biopsy in a child with IgA vasculitis who might have an abnormal urine dipstick. And we went on to hold an international meeting and an international workshop to actually make some of the recommendations from SHARE into a more user-friendly format. And this included using things like the serum creatinine rather than the estimated GFR, which is not often done in routine practice. And so we've now published in this letter to editor in a response to the SHARE criteria, some indications for when to do a biopsy in a child with IgA vasculitis where you're suspicious of nephritis. And this includes absolute indications if you have severe proteinuria, so urine protein to urine creatinine ratio of over 250 milligrams per millimoles for 4 weeks. If you have persisting moderate proteinuria, so if you had a slightly lower urine protein to creatinine ratio, but it had gone on for longer, so for 3 months, or if you had acute kidney injury, so if the creatinine was elevated to over 1.5 of the baseline or the upper limit of normal for their child's age, then that would be an indication for a biopsy. Or if they presented with nephrotic syndrome, so they had edema, low serum albumin, and heavy proteinuria. We classified relative indications as those children who had severe proteinuria, so the urine protein to creatinine ratio was over 250 at any time point, and they're the group that you might be chatting to the nephrologist about whether it's the time to do a biopsy or not. And a relative indication as those who have an elevated creatinine above the upper limit of normal. And so these have now been published, and hopefully this will begin to try and standardise when children can access a renal biopsy from this condition and allow us to build on some of the evidence that is lacking in this condition. So our current management, so a child presents with IgA vasculitis, and what we do for the kidneys is we do the urine monitoring and we watch and wait, and then we see if there's any signs of renal inflammation in the urine, and they may then get further investigations. And there have been large studies looking